Science is going beyond the rainbow, beyond the visible, beyond the obvious. Doing science also has a joy of its own. The joy of seeing patterns, of finding harmony in nature. But at the same time, science is also a very effective instrument to transform the society, as Pandit Nehru had envisioned. Science contributed tremendously to the well-being of the society. But the fact remains that common man's feeling for science ranges from a blind reverence to that of fear. Isaac Asimov has cautioned against the perils of a public ignorant of science. Public lectures on science, interpreting science to public, therefore assume great significance. Faraday's initiation into serious science being a consequence of Davy's public lectures at the Royal Institution is a part of folklore by now. Talking about science is best not left to the ignoramuses. It's best to hear about science, its scope, from those who have experienced the joy and ecstasy of discovering. University of Lucknow celebrated its 85th anniversary in the year 2006. And to mark the occasion, it was decided to hold public lectures by three eminent scientists. Professor C.N.R. Rao, Honorary President and Linus Pauling Professor at Jawaharlal Nehru Center for Advanced Scientific Research, Bangalore. Dr. Raghunath A. Mashelkar, Director General, CSIR. And a well-known material scientist, Professor M. Vijayan from Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. These lectures, held at Malviya Hall of the University of Lucknow on 12th and 16th of February, were inaugurated by His Excellency, Governor of Uttar Pradesh, Shri T. Rajeshwar, on 12th of February.
I welcome you to this presenting.
The guests were welcomed by Professor R.P. Singh, a material scientist of international repute and Vice Chancellor of the University of Lucknow.
To give it off. Light symbolizes knowledge. May I request our honorable guests to kindly light the lamp.
For mediates in this world, science forms the basis of comfortable living. For many, science is a vocation. There are some others who also live off it. But for some, very few, science is a way of life. Chintamani Nagesha Ramachandra Rao is one such person. One whose fondest early memories consist of a three-hour meeting at the age of 11 with Nobel laureate Professor C.V. Raman, which is imprinted as the most vivid and inspiring impression in his mind even today. He was born to Mrs. Nagamma and Sri Nagesh Rao on June 30, 1934 as Basavanagudi in Bangalore. He had an education at different schools in the erstwhile Mysore state. India achieved freedom meanwhile, also leaving indelible impression on young Rao's mind. He finished master's degree at BHU and then completed doctorate at Purdue University, USA. On return, he joined ISC and then IIT Kanpur to become its dean later and again returned to ISC and became its director. On completing his junior secondary examination at the age of 10, he had been rewarded with a rupee by his great-grand-aunt, to which his father affectionately had added a quarter. This was his first reward, but certainly not the last. He went on to win the highest laurels in India, including Bhatnagar Award in 1968, capped by Padma Vibhushan in 1985, and the first Bharat Vigyan Samman in 2006. He was conferred with honoris causa DSc by three dozen universities such as Purdue, Wales, and most recently by University of Lucknow. He interacted with the who's who in science and the world. He was presented the American Chemical Society Medal by Nobel laureate Glenn C. Bogue. he received Marlowe Medal, International Somia Award by Materials Research Society at San Francisco, a medal from Japan government, and in 2005, Chevalier de la Légion d'Honneur by France. He had been chosen fellow of all the major academies of the world, including the Royal Society, US Academy of Sciences, and the Third World Academy of Sciences. He took major responsibilities to build science in India. He is chairman of the Science Advisory Committee to the Prime Minister. When Outlook magazine sought opinions of the 7 leading Indian scientists and science journalists to list the most potential Indian Nobel laureates, 5 had C.N.R. Rao on top of their lists, evincing the respect he commands. His hundreds of papers, over 60 awards, many fellowships, and about 40 books don't completely describe him. His dynamo-like energy, care for details, intolerance to mediocrity, and an innate sense of integrity are integral part of his personality. Einstein is said to have quipped, "I never think of the future, it comes too soon." But future is what entices us, also scares, motivates, and draws forward. History has shown that future of mankind is closely linked to science. Here is Professor C.N.R. Rao to tell us why science.
His Excellency the Governor of Uttar Pradesh, Mr. Rajeshwar, Dr. Mashelkar, Dr. Singh, my many good friends in Lucknow, whose names I cannot mention because there are many of them, members of the MRSI, distinguished citizens of Lucknow, ladies and gentlemen. I am very glad to be here this evening to give a lecture. The topic is science for our future. It is not the future of science. If you talk of future of science or science of the future, that will be a different talk. For example, suppose I were to talk about science of the future, what would I say? What is the kind of challenge that science faces today? What are the scientific problems that really challenge man's mind today? That is what I would be talking. In fact, there is another talk, very exciting, and unfortunately I am not going to talk about it. Let me give an example. One of the important challenges we have, typical example for a physicist, is it possible to make a superconductor at room temperature, in which case the entire world will change if you have a room temperature superconductor? That is a challenge. Another challenge, do we know exactly how the universe was created? Of course, we know it was the Big Bang. Nobody knows at the Big Bang what happened, or just before the Big Bang what happened. It is important to know the answer, how this universe was created. Similarly, many such questions are there. They represent science of the future. The future of science, I will not talk too much about it, but science for our future has a slightly different meaning. Why and how we require this extraordinary effort of human beings, extraordinary creative thing, the creative accomplishment of human beings over centuries, this science. Why do we need it? How do we need it for our future? That is what I am going to talk about. But first of all, let me assure you that science will go on whether you want it or not. Science is not being practiced by people because governments are giving grants. Unfortunately, it is a false impression of governments and various people in power that science has been created by them. No. Science has been going on for ages when there were no governments. Science was done when there were no research grants. Science was done by people like Michael Faraday when there were no PhD students. So science is an essential urge of a human being. As long as human urge for creativity is there, science will be there. So I do not want to ever accept anyone who patronizes science and say, look here, because of us, because of our government or any other particular man-made situation, science exists. It's not true. Therefore, I am not worried about the future of science. Science will continue as long as human beings are there with their intellect. But what we are interested in is how this important activity of man is going to affect us in India, and what is its role in India's future, and what is the science, the kind of thing we should be doing in science for our future. And this topic, when you do that, I would like to briefly mention a our past, recent past. I will not be talking about the history of science in India. That is a very long story. But what we should know is, since we got independence, 1947, of course, I was a college student when India got freedom. Because even though the situation, financial situation of India, the economic conditions in India were not very, very sound at that time, we didn't have foreign exchange, we didn't have much money, we were a poor little country which became independent. In spite of that, this country was one of the few countries which decided that science had a major role in the development of this country. In fact, India is the only country, as far as I know, among the republics of the world, which made a declaration in the parliament because of Pandit Nehru that science was not only essential, but science was a tool of development, and everything will be done by the Indian government to accrue the benefits of science for mankind. It's the only probably government that they do. You know, America does not have a resolution of the Congress. George Washington didn't do that. Even Jefferson didn't do that. Pandit Nehru did that. So this we do not forget. Our heritage, as our science is concerned in India, is something remarkable. And at least many of you remember, people who are senior to me here or of my age group here, will remember the tremendous aspiration and ambition we had. None of us was promised a job in India. None of us was told you will have a wonderful future, bright future, you'll be comfortable, you'll have a car, you'll have money. Nobody said that. But we all wanted to do science, we all wanted to take up science, because some dream, some romantic association of the future of India with science. It was a romantic association of science and India. That romance still continues, but it has changed a lot. Today's situation is a bit different, I'll come back to that. It is this romance that really created institutions. The belief and faith that institutions in science will really change India. CSIR, the number of laboratories that came up, under great difficulty. We didn't have the money, we still created those institutions. I don't know whether you know how atomic energy was created. Atomic energy, for those who may not know, many young people do not know that. Mr. Homi Bhabha, the famous Dr. Homi Bhabha, wrote a letter to Pandit Nehru saying, you know, I think atomic energy is very important for the future of India. I think there should be a department, not only a department, and for that, I think I should be the secretary. He wrote himself. And Pandit Nehru, that document can be seen in Delhi. And Pandit Nehru said, wrote to Mr. Bhatnagar, who was his right-hand man, said, if a great scientist like Homi Bhabha wants to be a secretary to government, I have no objection. That's what Pandit Nehru wrote on that paper. It's unbelievable. Atomic energy was created in the early 50s. If you remember, in Bombay, in the old Yacht House, we were all students in MSc at that time, or something like that. And look at, whatever it is, these agencies, like atomic and much later space, these agencies were created. And you cannot say these agencies have done badly, they have done extremely well. All the mission-oriented programs of India have done reasonably well. We have provided whatever has to be provided in atomic energy. And our space program is certainly wonderful. We can fly 30-ton rocket, 30-ton payloads. We can put up with our own huge GSLV with our own rockets. It's something we cannot deny. But what we cannot forget is, in the early days when we started research, say in 50s, there was a big gap between us and the West. There was a big gap. We were all frustrated. For example, when I started my career in the Indian Institute of Science as a young staff member, after I came back from the United States, you know, after BHU, I went to the United States. After that, I came back to India, took my first position in the Indian Institute of Science. Here was a big chemistry department, but there was not a single spectrometer in our institute. There was no equipment. But you know, we built our own, we wound our own little furnaces, did some research. We always had hope, some hope that something will change. Of course, things changed. Slowly, equipment came here and there. For example, I eventually came to Kanpur myself, IIT Kanpur, where I was one of the first heads of the department here. I was the chemistry department head in the early 60s. And things changed. We had some equipment. We started doing research. But the hope in the 60s was that within a matter of time, India will bridge the gap. India will be as good as any other country in science. That was the hope which we all had. And that was the hope of CSIR and agencies like that. Because the two important words in the early independent India was self-sufficiency and self-reliance. Unfortunately, these two words are completely out of context today. But elements of that should not be forgotten. It may not be in the same spirit, we may not require import substitution like in the old days, but still self-reliance was something basically not a bad idea. You must have self-reliance in something or the other. At least in intelligence we should be self-reliant, if nothing. Now I think this gap we assumed was going to close. In fact, till about 1990 or the late 80s, this, in spite of the gap, science went on. In fact, you know, my only hope in the 80s was, look, we are not so far away. We can actually bridge this gap, become equal to anybody. Well, unfortunately or fortunately, situations have changed. The change in scenario since the late 80s or early 90s have been remarkable. I hope you all remember, suddenly the Soviet bloc went. There was geopolitical scenario changed. There was all command economies got wiped out. Globalization started coming in. Free economies everywhere. In fact, today in India, you can get almost everything that you can buy in the United States. In fact, there is too much. We do not, in fact, all the countries in the world want to come and sell here. In fact, they are not coming because they love you and me. No, no. Because there are 350 million middle-class Indians, 300 million middle-class Indians, just like in America, the same number. They also buy televisions and cars. All companies want to sell us. That's why they are coming. No love, no love. And I think this is a wonderful thing. There are two things that have happened. Suddenly, India looks good because there's a big middle-class population. And at the same time, what has happened to other things, other aspects? What has happened is, in this global scenario, there is competition in everything. You want to produce technology, you have to compete with the best. You want intellectual property, you have to produce your own intellectual property. You can't buy and sell so easily. You have to create wealth if you want to compete. Otherwise, you can always buy something. But you have to create your own knowledge. So the competition is becoming severe because the number of competing countries, number of competing economies has increased. What is that competing economies I'm talking about? See, before we always talked about United States, Europe, we talked about sometimes Japan, not much as much of Japan as we did about Europe, because India has always been a little bit looking at the West a bit more. But what has happened suddenly is Asia surrounding us, a lot of economies have come up. In the last few years, China has emerged in a very big way. Of course, Japan has always been there. South Korea, extraordinary performance in everything. I'll come back to that later. Taiwan, a small country, and a small city like Singapore, the way they have come up, they've all become centers of extraordinary performance in not only business, but even in science. I'll come back to that later. Suddenly this change after the 90s and today, India is facing a different kind of competition. While the so-called gap between us and the advanced countries we used to talk about in the 60s, well, still the gap continues. Many of our education institutions still do not have the facilities of the best universities elsewhere. Still the gap continues. The poverty has increased in certain respects in our institutions. Poor have become poorer. At the same time, there are also this tremendous middle class population, tremendous business in India, IT boom, BT boom, and all kinds of booms. So we are doing exports. India has been fairly well in economy. I think we have never done better. So it's a peculiar mixture of circumstances where a fairly affluent India stays, along with it, a fairly poor, fairly not so advanced situation in its education. Lot of illiteracy still continues. Our universities not being well equipped, having poor infrastructure continues, and lot of poor people still there. But that is one aspect. Today I'm not going to talk about that. I'm only talking about science. In science, what has happened is this competition has also affected science in a very big way. In the last 3 years or so, if you look at the research scenario in the world, what is it that you see? Well, first of all, before I compare other countries and India, the way we do research has changed. See, I have been doing research for the last 54 to 55 years, of which about 46 years I've been a professor in this country. And in this, with this experience, what I can see is the way I could publish outstanding journals, very difficult journals, you could publish papers. Not so difficult, we could do that reasonably well, say about 30 years ago. Slowly it became more and more difficult. In fact, today, if you want to publish a good experimental paper in a major journal in the world, it's very, very difficult. It's extremely difficult to publish because the requirements of a good piece of scientific work are much higher today than any other time. The kind of characterization you do, the kind of measurements you do, the kind of theory you do, the kind of, in fact, even experimental papers have a lot of theory quite often, or quite a, all this requires a tremendous capability in our scientists. So that requirements have increased. So I find it much more difficult, though I continue to publish a lot, whether that has not stopped me from publishing, but I can tell you it is extremely difficult to publish. And I could publish the same journals 20 or even 10 years ago rather easily. Today, competition is difficult. So in fact, particularly it has hit experimental sciences. Experimental sciences, the kind of experiments you do, for example, in advanced materials, since you are meeting as a materials research society here, or experimental physics, or good experimental chemistry, any area, is very difficult. Maybe biologists are slightly better off, I'm not sure. But anyway, this requirement has made tremendous demands on Indian science. How to be competitive? And in the meantime, of course, there are little changes also. We have done well in IT. Our biggest exports are IT. In fact, Bangalore City, they say, exported close to 5.5 to 6 billion software, $6 billion worth of software last year. So that way we are making progress. I'm not denying that. There are wonderful biotechnology companies coming up right in Bangalore. But we coexist with it. This tremendous competition to be able to do good basic science, which we are finding difficult to meet this challenge. Why do you say we are finding it difficult? I think we should look at our universities. Our universities produced 50, in fact there was a survey done, I was part of the survey, my old friend Ray Zahmer did that many years ago along with others. 55 to 60% of the good research in India was done by our universities about 20 years ago, 25 years ago. Madras University, or you mentioned it, Lucknow University, Benares University, they were all centers of research. But I went to Benares University mainly because it was one of the good centers of research in my days. So these universities have dried up. Where Benares, instead of 1,000 PhD students, probably we have a few hundred PhD students today. There are great institutions, you know, I will never forget where I come from. I come from this land, Uttar Pradesh, from BHU. And these great universities have slowly dried up. Because of that, today, roughly 10% of the research done in the world, done in India, is from the universities. It is a very sad thing. We have to do something about that. Maybe 10, if you want to be generous, make it 20, I don't mind, but it is very small. But other than that, the gap I talked about has increased in a different way, in terms of competition. I was one of the Indians who went as the member of the first delegation to China after the Cultural Revolution. Some of us went. China was in terrible shape. It was such a bad shape that we came back with a big smile. My God, we in India are so well off. China, you know, there were no lights. In fact, there will be a big lab of this size. There will be two little bulbs, you know, dark laboratories, cold, no heating, very poor laboratories. You always wondered. In fact, some of the laboratories we used to go in the corridors would be full of cabbages and cauliflower. I remember M. G. Kevin and myself, I said, why is it your corridors, you can't even walk, full of cabbage? No, you see, we have to give some food for all our workers. We give all the vegetables from the lab to our workers. No, that was the condition. No, it is unbelievable. And that was, then you see, China used to publish about 5 to 10,000, less than 10,000 papers. India was publishing close to 15,000 research papers per year. For example, let us take one subject, like my subject. 8.75% of the world's chemistry was done in India. 8.75% of the world's chemistry done by India. Just about 15 years ago, 20 years ago. Today it is 2.75. We have come down roughly 1/4. Well, this is not my figures. These figures have been tested by a number of people. So if you don't like 2.7, make it 3. I don't mind. So don't argue with me about little changes in numbers. But I have seen these numbers from various sources, including the latest numbers that came from some of the Indian analysts about science. Okay, that is the only thing. So we have come down just subject like chemistry, where we were really fairly good. So China, in the meantime, is publishing enormously. The total percentage of papers, published papers from China, percentage of the total world, in the world, is very, very high. It is almost it almost reached 5%. And the percentage of the world total publication, we are about 2 or 3%. And more than that, forget about the numbers, you may say. Because China, there is a lot of, they go on repeating the same paper 3 times. So if I publish 15,000, I will remove 5,000 out of that. But that doesn't matter. But out of the bad so-called numbers, there are still a lot of good papers, don't forget. So another way of counting it is, what they have done is the world's top 1% of the publications. If you take the highest cited, the best papers of the world, top 1%, China has reached almost 2% of that in the world is Chinese. India is 0.5%. And the number of papers published by India today is the same as South Korea. South Korea is a little country. By the way, for those who may not remember history, South Korea got freedom at the same time as India, 1947, around that. So South Korea is same as India in number of papers. Citations and so on, they're all just as good, in fact, slightly better than India. Brazil has come equal to India now. Brazil is the same as India in the top 1% of the papers. And recently we had a meeting in the, of all places, in Singapore, where China, Japan, all the Asian countries presented their future predictions for science. I was amazed, some of the Indian friends were there. And the meeting was coordinated by an American professor, very close friend of mine, from University of California. And he, when I was chairing, this South Korean comes, the president of their academy, and says, South Korea will publish 30,000 research papers in the next 5 years, per year. I wish I could get up and say the same about India. Can I say we will publish 30,000? Well, you may say, oh, it's not good, bad, I'm not worried about quality, just the number. And they say their citations will be 5% of the world, top 1%. This is how he presented it. Of course, China, I don't want to tell you. The numbers they gave were frightening, so I don't want to tell you, because some of you may have a heart attack if you hear those numbers. Their predictions, they're making crazy predictions. China said they'll beat the United States. They'll be same as US in about 10 years. Numbers. Of course, China is saying that about sports. I don't know if you know that. China has now said, secretly sometimes, but no, even openly, in the next Olympics in Beijing, they will beat the United States. Number one. Because they are already doing that in army, number of soldiers in the world is maximum is Chinese. I guess they will have the maximum of rockets and every damn thing they want. I'm sorry. Sorry for the word damn. But the real point is, in science, I'm only worried about science. They are extraordinary figures. The amount of money they are putting, let us take nanotechnology, nanoscience. They have put a few $100 million in that last few years. They are investing in a big way in people. I'll come back to one point about China later. South Korea. Then, what was amazing was the way Taiwan is investing. For example, we are now talking under Lucknow University. In fact, our governor was asking me about the 100 crores gift the finance minister has given to Indian society. The money has not yet come, though it was given 1 year ago. But it's yet to come. But more than that, it is nothing. You know what South Korea, Taiwan has announced? In fact, I'm going there next month. Taiwan has announced to make its national university one of the world's best. They want it to be same as Harvard, Cambridge. See, I know Cambridge University and Berkeley and all very well. I've been assigned as a professor in these universities. It's not easy to equal them. But they're saying, we will do that. They have decided to give $100 million a year for the next 10 years to National Taiwan University, as of this year. Per year, $100 million. That is the government commitment. So where this is the kind of scenario. Now, in the end, the last presentation was our host, Singapore. And I didn't know Singapore numbers until a few months ago. Singapore last year's expenditure on research development was $1 billion. You see, the salaries in Singapore are high. South Korea gives almost American salaries. We all get no salaries, as you know. We work free. Compared to in dollars, it's almost free. We'll not count our salaries. Even then, that money being invested is extraordinary. So this is a new company. Maybe my very dear friend, Dr. Mashelkar, can tell you. This is a competition of a different kind. That is what I want to point out. I'm not talking about come here to cry over your shoulder, oh, we are so bad, what do we do? No, that's not that. We'll do something. But how do you face this competition? It's a new kind of competition. Everybody wants to invest more. Japan is investing like mad. As you know, 5 years ago, they decided to give $201 million grant. They thought it was great. 200 people were chosen. Each one was given $1 million. Just like that. Any idea you have? $1 million. Like that, they're funding in a big way, Japan. That they're always doing. Now, China and South Korea, Taiwan, because they're all next to us. They're all in Asia. I'm not going to America, you see. I'm not touching Europe. Well, this is a thing you have to think about. What are we going to do? Are we going to keep quiet and say, look here, we are, well, you know, we poor, you know, India, we are doing, you know, prayers and all. No, no, we will continue to do prayers, but what about science? Doing science. You see, one thing that, other than investments, of course, we have to improve our universities. I will come to that in a minute. The present government, they are trying to do something. It is not only investment, but also performance. Both we have to worry about. Investment will make more. Can we assure performance? This is something we have to think about. What is one thing that is lacking, I found, is nationalism of the kind we say in China. In fact, my wife and I often talk about that. Everywhere you go in China, doesn't matter how many times, these young boys and girls who are all PhD students in the academy laboratories, they take you around. You know, they're so proud to be research scholars of the academy. You know, I wish all our young people are equally proud of being working in India. I am very proud to be. I've done everything in my country, in this country. I'm very grateful to this poor country which has supported me. I'm very proud to be an Indian. But of course, I complain like everybody does. But without complaints, you can't have good life. You have to complain. But, you know, are we proud of doing things in India? This nationalism, I think we have to worry about a little bit. Because I don't want to say anything because many of you will be upset. Because we take pride in saying all of our children are abroad. In fact, how successful you are as a citizen in India is determined by how many children are in the United States. Sir, fikar mat kijiye, my children are all in America. Everything is okay. Nobody says, my parents belong to another generation. When I finished my PhD, postdoctoral, they were so happy I came back to India. My parents wanted me close to them, not far away. Now it is the other way around. That is nothing to do with nationalism. That is something else. But I do want our people to be proud of India a little bit. This country has done a lot for us. I really think this country, you know, my friend Nityanand and some of our old timers can know, this country has really done something for us. Has built institutions. Look at our CSIR lab. Look at all the, how much it has done. How come we can't be a little grateful, little thankful to this country and say something? Look, let me do something. But nobody is going hungry, I want you to know. We are all very well off. I am quite well off. I am quite happy. I don't need any more money. I think God has been very kind to me. I don't think we need any more. So we have to have that. I hate to stress anything to do with nationalism. It is not an attractive thing or not a popular thing to talk about it. But oh, we are coming back to the future. Recently, in fact, for more than 3-4 years, there has been a lot of discussion in the world on what is the future picture, future landscape of the world. There are a lot of discussion. You may have read some articles about that. What will the world look like, say, 25 to 50 years from now? Somewhere in that period. Middle of the century or another 30 years from now. Almost all Asians believe the one that will pick up in the world will be Asia. The reason is Asian countries will be better than all European countries in science in the next 15 years, 10 years. Already Asian countries are pretty close to Europe. Pretty close. So Asia will be equal to Europe, and it will beat the United States in 20 years. Definitely, all Asia, in science. Not only in science, even in economy. Look at our economic powers now. Of course, Japan, China, India, South Korea, Taiwan, Singapore, each one will be a giant economic in the economic scenario. And India certainly will be one of the major nations, there is no question. But in science, what about that? I do not see in the long run how we can be so advanced industrially, economically, unless we are also advanced in science. Because I do not know any country which is advanced economically and industrially without being advanced in science. So any temporary gains may be gone unless we make sure something about our competitiveness in science. That is what I'm worried about. We have to be as good in science as we are in IT or something else. And when Asia becomes top, India should be a leading partner. Not a secondary partner. We should not go looking for friendship like that. Others should come for our hand, for our hand. And if that has to happen, we have to do many things. We have to improve our scientific institutions. We have to invest more. And we have to be a bit more responsible for receiving that kind of encouragement. We have to perform better. Every scientist in India, with no exception, has to perform better. I looked up all the performance. The best of our institutions have done reasonably well, not as well as they should be doing. My conclusion is, I'm not going to criticize universities. It's usually, universities are not doing well. No, even the best institutions have not done as well. Our IITs, for example, take a major IIT like IIT Kanpur. I'm now the chairman of that IIT Kanpur. We produced only 61 PhDs last year. That's it. There are IITs with 400 faculty produce 30, 40 PhDs per year. And China producing hundreds of PhDs. Brazil produced last year 10,000 PhDs. We produced 5 or 6,000. Your number of PhDs were not produced. Why are we not working harder? The old times we used to produce. Why not now? What about more papers? Higher quality papers? Better journal papers? More higher impact papers? Why not? Why can't we do that? That is the responsible side. You know, we can't say, we can't blame today. Well, money is, as you know, is available more today than any other time. Suppose we give hundreds of crores of rupees to everybody that needs money. Do you think our quality will improve? It requires the mind. That is why I am worried about. It requires the mind of all of us, the heart and the mind. We have to decide we are going to serve this country through science. We have to decide we are going to produce, we have to stretch ourselves beyond our capability. Anyone who has worked hard has produced good results in India. It's just hard work. I tell you, I always tell about myself, you know, if all the intelligent people I knew had worked, I would have had no place. Amazing thing is, intelligent people don't work much. People like me have a good chance because of that. I can do much better. I think average people have tremendous chance to do good work in India. Don't worry about it. But who are the engineers who have served India most? Not IITs, ordinary colleges, engineering colleges, regional colleges of engineering. Don't forget. All of our defense, atomic energy, space, completely served by ordinary engineers of India, not IIT graduates. The reason I'm telling you is, even ordinary people can do a lot of extraordinary work. For that, we need good institutions. I always remember Lord Blackett, what he told Pandit Nehru. Some of you may remember, when he came to India in 1950s, Lord Blackett, in fact, this is the famous statement of Blackett, when he was asked to define what is a good institution. He said, a good institution, a first-rate institution, what is the definition? A first-rate institution is one, he said, where ordinary people go and do extraordinary work. We should create our ordinary institution to do extraordinary work. Our brilliant scientists should come out of Lucknow University, Banaras University, every university of Uttar Pradesh, every university of India, every IIT, and hundreds of them should come. We need probably per year 15,000 PhDs produced in India, not 4,000 that we are producing. We are short of good talent. Good people should take science. Unfortunately, I'm not going to cover that, how young people are not interested in science. Today is not the time. We have to, of course, attract talent, give them scholarships. Because there are a few measures the present government is taking. Of course, in addition to improve the universities, a new panel has been created based on the advice of the Science Advisory Council to the Prime Minister. Per year, 600 crores have been given to this committee to improve the universities. Per year. That is going to start functioning very soon. 2-3 new institutions, one in Punjab is going to come next year. 3 new Indian Institutes of Science are being created, one in the West, one in the East, Pune and Calcutta, next one in Punjab. 2 more will be created later. Many things, the new National Science Foundation is being created. Several things will be done. I know in the end, it is just this is only an essential condition, but sufficient, it is not sufficient condition. It is necessary to have money, but what about the mind? What about our extraordinary admiration of the West? Why, you know, how about a ordinary loyalty to India? A simple loyalty to work in India. Why do you think all these big companies are coming, General Electric? Not because they love India. They think this is a wonderful bed of intelligence. But wonderful, bright young people. But if they soon find out there are no scientists in India, there are no one we are producing, they will also not come. We, as Mashalkar will keep on talking about, knowledge century, knowledge will be the thing. What knowledge? Not IT and all sending a bunch of engineers to earn some money in United States, no. If India has to be the power knowledge, power of knowledge, for knowledge power, center of knowledge, what we should be giving is the highest form of knowledge to all the countries in the world. I tell you, America will be short of talent because they're all old people. They're all very old. American average age is very high. European average age is high. We are the youngest country in the world. 65% of Indians are 35 or below. We are the youngest nation. Our young people, therefore, should grow up to give advice to the world. If they want to know best design for a dam, best chemical plant, they have to come to India to get the best design. They want to build an aircraft, they come to India. They want to know, learn good biology and chemistry, they have to come to India. That will happen. It won't happen if we are second rate in science. The challenge is before us. It is for us to take up. Don't think I'm exaggerating. Please, I'm getting old. People have accused me of getting over emotional or no, it's not exaggeration. Real situation is worse than what I have told you, actually. Please, let us, for our own sake, for the sake of our country, save science. Not because science requires science. Science can go without it in the world, but our country needs this science. Our future needs this science. Thank you.